The following podcast is intended for mature audiences. If you enjoy our work, please like, comment, subscribe, and follow the links in the description. Thanks for your support, and enjoy.
Greetings and salutations, listener. It is I, Eric J. Chucky, joined as always by my fellow Click member, the boy.
Eh.
This is a Two Nerds podcast, and probably going to be kind of a low-energy Two Nerds podcast. Today we're talking about King of the Ring 1996. And the words low-energy and King of the Ring 1996, did you just stab me?
I whapped you slightly with a grabbing machine.
Do not belong in the same sentence.
Alright, so, as you know, listener, us watching these classic pay-per-views was an experiment, and up until now, we've had a really good time with them, I think that would be fair to say.
Yeah, I think last pay-per-view was kind of a stinker, anyway.
Like, they haven't all been winners, but they've been generally a positive experience.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first time since we started the experiment, and I think you pointed this out rightly when we were done watching it, that we didn't have the best time, and it was firmly not the show's fault. Because King of the Ring 1996 is a good fucking show.
Legendary, I'd say.
Yeah. I mean, the matches were all really high quality. Well, not all.
They were medium quality, at least.
Yeah, there were no bad matches.
No.
Even the rematch between Shawn Michaels and the British Bulldog was pretty good.
It was okay, yeah. That's some good spots. Really good spots.
It was to the arm drag what the Bret Hart Shawn Michaels Iron Man match was to the headlock. Or no, not the arm drag, excuse me, the Irish whip. But still, it wasn't a bad match. And there were some legendarily good matches on there. And also, in this pay-per-view was the beginning of the pop cultural tidal wave, of which I was a member. Back in the day, this was the start of Stone Cold Steve Austin really being Stone Cold Steve Austin.
The birth of Austin 316, and that's the bottom line.
In the same promo, seconds apart. And I was kind of bored with this show. So bored. In fact, I want to get this right out front. There's one match I don't remember, because despite the fact that I wasn't tired at all, and I was literally up for several more hours, not tired after that, I fell asleep during that match. I woke up right after it was done, wasn't tired at all, but I fell asleep during the Goldust Ultimate Warrior match, I believe it was, yes?
Goldust and...
No, that was a couple months ago. It was Goldust and Ahmed Johnson.
You didn't fall asleep during the Goldust Ultimate Warrior match.
No, that was a weird experience.
dreamlike, one might say.
Yes.
Shattered dreamlike.
One might if one was gold dust. I see. You want to run? I mean, we're going to run down the card, because otherwise we literally have...
Yeah. Thanks for enjoying the podcast. Fuck it, let's get hardcore.
But there's not a whole wealth of stuff to say. It was a good show.
Well, and as you said, this might be the beginning of, or as you were about to say, us not watching the weekly show having an impact on the quality of the pay-per-view. On our enjoyment, rather, of the pay-per-view.
On our investment.
Sure.
Because, by all rights, I should have been super invested in this show. This show had a bunch of shit I cared about in it, and it was the show literally the show I've been waiting to watch since we started this experiment.
Mm-hmm.
Was this pay-per-view, for the obvious reason. And, like, I just, when it came around, I didn't give a fuck. Like, I was interested to watch that promo, but I've watched that promo before.
Sure, who hasn't?
So, the match preceding it was an absolute squash.
Yeah.
For storyline reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But, meh. It was good. Well, that match was a squash. It was a good squash match. Like, for what it was, it did well.
Yeah.
Alright, so... Well, let's go through the card, and then we'll visit the theory that we came up with at the end once we've gone through all the matches.
Sure.
All right, first match was Mark Merrow fighting Stone Cold Steve Austin in a semifinal match. They went 16 minutes.
That was really good. I dug this a lot. I've said it before. I'll say it again. I think Mark Merrow was criminally underrated. I think that Sable's boobs stole all of his heat is horrible.
Also, they're only okay boobs. But
they were boobs, and it was the 90s.
Fair. But... yeah, no, I believe I've mentioned on the podcast before, I don't really give a fuck about Mark Merrow, but, like, no, he was better than he got.
Yeah, watching him now, you're really, like, noticing what I've been talking about. Now, I had been reintroduced to him, because I saw, like, the tail end of Mark Merrow's career. That was around when I got back into wrestling, was just before Sable kicked him to the curb. And here, a couple years ago, when I started watching WCW, I saw him... in the lead-up to his debut when we started watching these pay-per-views, when he was Johnny B. Bad, I think. It's a decent gimmick for the time, not crazy over, but whatever. He was still good in the ring, and he's good in the ring here. He and Austin put on a really great match. I think it went a little long for an opener, and I think that hurt the show.
But I think they wanted it to go long because they wanted to sell both guys. They wanted to sell Stone Cold as kind of worn down going into a second match. Mm-hmm. And up until now, Mark Merrow had been undefeated.
Right.
So they wanted to sell him as, you know, super tough and having a lot of heart. And I think it needed to go about as long as it did, even if it did, like, adjust the pacing of the show a little bit.
Yeah.
Just for, like, storyline reasons.
I mean, it wasn't terrible. There were a couple points where it wasn't blowing my skirt up. So.
I would have rearranged this match, the next match and the one after it, I think.
Yeah.
The next match was the next King of the Ring semifinal match. I'd have put a match in between those.
Makes sense.
Was Vader versus Jake Roberts. Jake wins by DQ.
Yeah, this wasn't really even a match.
Like, no, it was 3 minutes. It was a Goldberg, it was a Brock Lesnar match.
Yeah, it was a weird match. Squash that ended in a disqualification.
And Jake hit the DDT, but I guess they didn't want to bury Vader by having him go down, so they had Vader DQ himself when he was about to get DDT'd.
I would say it was something Cornette decided. That's my guess.
This feels right.
I'm not as into the wrestling industry and the backstage politics as some of my friends are, I'm sure. As has happened in the past, I will get a little message and it'll say, actually, this is what happened. Or, actually, you were right on the money. But
yeah, I'm interested. Wrestling guru who listens to the podcast, please tell us. Tell us, listener.
Ultimo Dragon knows, man. He was working at the time.
He knows, man. He had all those title belts and it was just...
Good old Ultimo Dragon. I don't fully... We're coming out of that, like, early 90s, where we still got that heady brew of the late 80s stinking on us, and nobody really seems to know what to do. Like...
Yeah, the show really... I think, actually, I'm gonna get way more interested in the next little while, because the show doesn't have a... There's no tone.
No, and I think, I mean, this is part of the Monday Night Wars, right? This is why WCW started winning, because shit was happening. Because this is past that nonsense that I was watching with Macho Man and stuff. This is during the heyday of the NWO, when they're getting started, and there's all that confusion and stuff. So, you know, this show kind of sucks.
But, like, the show itself, the card, and all the matches on that card are good.
Yeah, but tonally, it's just sort of, we don't know what to do. And I think Vader is symbolic of that, what are we doing? Because...
He's this great big, you know, mastodon. He's this great big dude who's supposed to be super dominant.
And he is, but he always cheats to win because his manager is a dick. And it seems like the crowd can't decide whether they love him or hate him.
Because, like, they want to love him because he's Big Bad Vader.
Yeah.
But, I mean, look, fucking... putting aside the real individual, the character of Jim Cornette, wrestling manager, is one of the most gloriously hateable dickweeds I've ever seen put to screen. My God, he's so good at getting heat. Just the absolute insane person, bald face lies. The Shaggy It Wasn't Me level of bald-faced lies he tells are... They work so well because it's comedic, and at the same time, if you were in there and you were invested in the faces winning, and he was just lying directly to your face about shit that happened 35 seconds before he started lying about it, you'd be so mad!
Oh, and this was before the hard death of kayfabe, before the internet got huge and, you know, this information spread around. So people were still bought into it. I'm sure they were still incensed. How dare he lie? We all saw what happened. Owen Hart did a great job with that through this entire show. He was on commentary with JR and Vince.
He was just cornetting it up. He was just... It literally, he made no effort to make sense as a character or to have any sort of internal consistency to his worldview. He just, whoever was the good guy in the match, he found the meanest, most hurtful shit he could say about them in that exact picosecond, said it, and when they proved him wrong a second later, said the exact opposite thing that was still mean. It's actually really fun.
Yeah, I'd say Owen's commentary was the highlight of this show, honestly. It was a squash match. I don't know what the hell you want.
Then we had the tag team title match.
This match I was super interested in. It wasn't quite match of the night like I was hoping it would be. I think, honestly, I really liked Ahmed and Goldust, but Stone Cold Mark Merrow was good, too.
The Smoking Guns beat the Godwins via chicanery for the tag team titles.
It was good. The Godwins didn't get to shine quite as much as they did last pay-per-view, but the storyline going into it was good. The storyline leaving it was good. Cloudy was a bit questionable.
Cloudy?
Yeah, the dude in a wig.
Oh! I totally forgot that happened.
Who was pretending to be Sunny.
I totally forgot that happened. My brain just edited that out for later viewing. We're just gonna forget that one, thanks. Snip, snip, snip. But this was perfectly good gimmick. You had the down-home, salt-of-the-earth country boys versus the dickhead, city-slicker, wannabe cowboys.
Yeah, I mean,
Who had just literally stolen his girl.
Yeah.
Billy
Gunn did a very, very, very brief promo at the top of the match, was like, I loved her in a way you never could, lol, and it was good shit.
Which then Vince called a prank, and I don't know if that's
a
prank. That's not a prank.
Boy, and I went back and forth on that one. I think I determined that Vince just
believes that Phineas I. Godwin is the world's greatest lover.
Yeah, and it's impossible that Billy Gunn could ever, you know,
top his romantic
succeed.
Prowess.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
The match was fun.
Yeah, it wasn't fun. It wasn't as good as the last Godwin match, but it was good. I liked it.
I know this is approaching sacrilege in your temple to Billy Gunn, but he's not that good at this point.
No, he was still pretty I don't want to say green, but he hadn't hit his style. He didn't hit his stride until the late 90s, honestly.
But like Bart Gunn is doing a fine job. Billy's doing... As JR says about Braun Strowman, he has a limited move pool, but what he has, he uses well.
There was a lot more brawling in this match that I wanted to see.
Which, I mean, makes sense, given the limited work pool that Billy was probably working with at this point. At least in terms of, you know, his style. And maybe there was some other stuff. Again, wrestling guru Ultimo Dragon, the listener, will tell us. But I think the theme of tonight is that the match was good. I don't really have anything specific to say.
I think we've got some specifics there. I think this had like probably the best story going into it. There wasn't anything really wacky or hard to understand. It was simple and effective, and I think it told its story well.
Yeah, 10 minutes.
Yeah,
fine.
10 minutes is a fine length for
next
match.
Thing. Again, I really would have switched this and the Jake Roberts Vader match just for pacing.
Well, you know, at the same time, you mentioned that, and my Booker mind goes through, you want both guys to be as fresh as possible. Let's kill those matches, one right after the other, the beginning of the card, that way both men...
Yeah, but the Jake match is 3 minutes.
Sure.
And, like, Jake's doing nothing in it. fair enough, yeah. He gave me the look that was, yeah, but.
Yeah, but the logic is there in the booking. Just because it's bad in pacing, it's one of those things where those two come to blows and you have to make a call. Me, in the same shoes, I probably would have made the same call.
I don't know.
But, you know, at the same time, I don't know if I would have given those other guys exactly the amount of time they got. So that might be the difference there.
Yeah.
And things were harder to control back then, too. So, I mean, you can tell when commentary, especially Vince, is going, oh, something's going on backstage or in the ring that I didn't approve of, and you all better shape the fuck up.
Yeah, he doesn't make really any bones about it. He doesn't come out and say, I'm going to fucking kill you later. But he's not happy.
No, yeah, you can tell. If you have the least bit of insider knowledge, you can tell when Vince is going,
motherfucker. Then we had Ultimate Warrior squashing the King.
Yes.
This
was what it was.
Was what it was. King's promo beforehand I want to make a quick shout out for, because he just spent like a solid, longer than the match, a solid 6 minutes bullying children.
Yeah. It's good heel work.
Just
man.
Straight up literally bullying actual real children. Like, he looked at a little 12-year-old girl who was, shall we say, had a high BMI, and like just fucking roasted her for like a solid minute, like 4 jokes.
That's old school shit, man. That's how they did it back.
And you know what the funny thing was? Like, she wasn't hurt or crying. She was like she was giving him back. She'd have a mic, and I'm sure her roasts weren't as good.
No,
but
well,
she was giving as good as she got.
It was a more innocent time in wrestling. These fans acted more like, you know, AAA fans than Triple H fans.
Hey!
One notable spot that you mentioned during the show was King drops a pile driver. By the way, there were like 3 or 4 pile drivers in this show. Holy shit, that's weird
God,
to see.
It's weird to see and really uncomfortable.
The King hits the pile driver, and Warrior just gets back up and starts running around like
the same way he did to Triple H's pedigree. Yeah. Same way, it's his gimmick. His gimmick is that he's in the Bullet Club. He knows wrestling's fake.
Thus, he is impervious to your moves.
He can just decide not to sell. I've decided not to sell your move.
But in all reality, you know, kayfabe, the Warrior is super tough, and the move just pissed him off, and it was good for what it was.
It rankled me because one of the most storied finishers in wrestling history, a move that will actually paralyze you if they fuck it up literally at all. And he just gets back up. People, you know what? All the old timers, all the old, like, classic wrestling fans or people who don't watch modern wrestling, was like, nobody sells anything anymore. Just gonna play them some Ultimate Warrior matches. And just point. I'm not even gonna say words. I'm just gonna point at Ultimate Warrior matches as they're playing. It's just. Anyway. Then we had Mankind versus The Undertaker, and I think this is where the show started to. I think this is where I started to fail the show.
You know, at the same time, I don't know. It was a good match, but there were a lot of really awkward rest periods.
Because this was Mankind at I wouldn't say the peak of his physical ability, but certainly like near the peak of the combination of his physical ability and ring like tactics.
It was pre-Hell in the Cell. We'll put it that way.
And it was and it was him versus The Undertaker and doing a 20-minute match where The Undertaker is fucking fighting fit and 21 years younger than when he retired. And it was good, and it opened up really strong, and then the match, and the match didn't lose me. I think I lost this match.
I don't know, man. I think this match gave you opportunities to be lost. It was like a mattress set up on cinder blocks. The middle bowed.
I'm not even gonna touch that. That was really clean imagery.
The end was great. The beginning was great. There were some great spots in it. Paul Bearer was absolutely perfect through the whole thing.
But the middle of this match, I actually commented on the time. I was like, this is Undertaker versus Mankind, and they're both in great shape, and this is a good match, and I'm bored as fuck.
But post-match was great, too.
Post-match was good.
Yeah.
Holding was like, the match, I would say, you might be right about the middle bit of it. I feel like I'm not ready to judge it fairly. I blame myself. I think you would agree overall the match was good.
Yeah. That nerve hold went on too long, and whatever happened before it that made me tune out went on too long.
Then we had the match I don't remember because I literally fell asleep. Like, I fell asleep maybe 3 minutes in, and I woke up basically when it ended. This match was 15 minutes long. I was asleep for maybe 10 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, you were out, dude.
And I was gone. Like, he was apparently talking to me, trying to wake me up, and like, the second that wrestling turned off, that match...
I turned off the show because I was tired, and I walked out of the room. I hit the first creaky floorboard, and he's like, bruh.
Maybe just the siren song of Ahmed Johnson is a natural lullaby for me. I'm not sure. Because it wasn't... I literally was up for hours after that. I wasn't tired. And a 10-minute nap is not going to wake you up. So I have no idea what the deal is.
I liked the match. I'm a big Goldust fan, and Goldust was really doing his shtick pretty well here.
There's a misbehaving cat.
That's the sound of discipline. She's looking at my wife's clothes hanging up like, you know, I could climb that.
You talk, I'll do this. I have nothing to add for this match.
Yeah, how could you? I like Ahmed Johnson. He works sloppy, but it looks good. It looks crazy good. And I like Goldust a whole bunch. And this wasn't... I find Goldust's best work didn't really show up until the Attitude Era. People talk about pre-Attitude Goldust, and he did, like, good stuff, but he spent so much time with the theatrics that he just wasn't as on in the ring. And this is even, you know, as we've said before, that Goldust today is a hell of a lot better than he was in the Attitude Era. So, I don't know. I enjoyed this match. I paid attention throughout it. I watched it. I liked it. It was good. But Austin Mero was probably better now that I'm sitting here actually thinking about it. I don't know that it was snoozeworthy.
I don't know. I don't know, and I didn't go back and watch, and I don't really care enough to. I'm sure it was a fine match, but I wouldn't know. Then we had the Stone Cold Steve Austin becoming King of the Ring thing that happened.
It was a beatdown.
Yeah, it was a beatdown. Like, for storyline reasons, Jake was all beat up, and... Get away from there. She's just impossible to dissuade.
Shecky, we're doing a podcast.
Jake was beat up, and Stone Cold wasn't as beat up, and Stone Cold beat up Jake the Snake Roberts. Gorilla Monsoon thought about stopping the match, gave Jake the Snake a minute to rest and recover. Gorilla Monsoon decided not to stop the match when Jake the Snake Roberts got in some cheap shots on Stone Cold. This was good. He was the face, by the way. And, like, that was the one moment where I thought Owen Hart's shitty asshole, bald-faced lie, ridiculous, crazy bastard heel commentary was just right. He was just right. Gorilla Monsoon just gave him an opportunity to rest, and then Jake got in cheap shots on Stone Cold.
It was like when Rey Mysterio had that mask, that knee brace that he was using
to hit people with.
Yeah.
It's like, no, he's the bad guy. What are you doing?
This D'Lo Brown did this exact angle with his stupid chest protector, and he was the heel. Are you crazy?
But the match was like 4 minutes.
Yeah, it wasn't anything great home about it. It's the promo afterward.
It's weird to see Stone Cold when he's like perfecting the stunner.
Yeah.
Because he debuted it like a week, literally a week before this show. The week before On Raw when he beat Savio Vega. In the quarterfinals, he debuted the Stone Cold Stunner.
It's even weirder to listen to JR talk about Stone Cold early and hear those early notes of what it would become.
Because he's a heel, but he's not giving him the full-on heel like JR put down. He's like talking him up to a certain degree, which, I mean, actually, if you go listen to JR's commentary, he does. He does that a lot. Like, he'll decry them as being... sociopath asshole crazy fuckers who that man has a family, but he puts heels over a lot as being like
he puts heels over with that man has a family alone.
Yeah, and like as intelligent and ruthless competitors, and he's doing this for Stone Cold, and he has, you can tell he's also like tweaking it. He's they're all dialing in on this new direction for the character, and watching Stone Cold dial in on the new direction for Stone Cold, because he's got about half of the thing the very technical wrestlery sort of, very restrained, very dour guy he was with when he was with Ted DiBiase, and he's like working in bits of the Texas Rattlesnake of what will become Stone Cold Steve Austin. And it's just, it's interesting to watch him workshop it.
Yeah, and it's amazing to hear, commentary calls like, oh, he hit him with, I guess that was almost a Luthez press. Yeah, JR, wasn't it?
Wasn't it, though, buddy?
That was kind of cool. But it wasn't like, this match especially, there wasn't a lot of commentary.
No, we're mostly honestly talking about, I think, the first match.
Yeah, the Mark Merrill match.
But you can watch him, he's workshopping Stone Cold Steve Austin. Mm-hmm. And then after the thing, the promo's there, and it's been a while since I watched the full thing. There's a lot of that promo that is straight up good heel promo, but then there's two bits that were so good the audience fully popped for them right then.
Yeah,
like Austin 316 says, "I just whipped your ass." The whole audience like cheered because that line taps into some sort of elemental well of fucking awesome lines.
Well, I mean, it's just so concise. It's, I have proved you wrong. Your philosophy did you no good. I'm the king.
I win. My win.
Yeah, and he delivers it so matter-of-factly. It's that exact moment of taking somebody else. We often talk about, the wrestling viewing public often talks about how Austin was the ultimate fuck your boss guy. You got to live vicariously through him as he beat the shit out of Vince McMahon. That's what made him big. But part of what started him out was, Jake the Snake comes in literally holier than thou and says, I'm going to say my prayers.
Jesus is on my side.
Jesus is on my side. And Austin's like, all right, where's Jesus?
Where was he? Dude, wasn't in your corner. I didn't see you tag him in.
You got all this shit to say about how you're so much better than me, and I just kicked your ass. So what do you want? I mean, and it should have been a heel promo because fucking Roman Reigns did the same thing earlier this year with like fucking four words, five, whatever the hell it was. But no, the crowd is like, this is brilliant.
Because he's right. And that combination of words, it just, you could tell it was electric.
Yeah.
And it was iconic. Even people, that's the thing. Of course I'm going to feel that way.
Right.
But even the people in the arena.
Yeah, it's the fact that they then
hear it.
Were like, that's awesome. That they
latched. Say that more, I want that on a t-shirt.
Hell yeah.
And they got it. By God, did they get the t-shirts. Then we had the main event. Boy howdy, was this a 30-minute match.
Yeah, I checked out of this shit.
I literally at one point went, Jesus, how much more of this do we have to go?
I kind of wish Sean was on more coke during this match.
they were both less high.
Yeah.
Which is good. He was on fewer, what was it, Quaaludes he was doing at this point?
No, man.
And Sean was on less coke. Maybe not no coke, but less coke. And it was a better match than their last one, except for these guys have, they have all the ring chemistry of John Cena and The Rock.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
They're both talented individuals. One maybe on the tail end of his career. One maybe in the mid prime of his career. But it doesn't matter because they have no fucking chemistry. They don't work well together. They're just not. Their styles don't mesh, and they don't know how to. And they don't know how to meet in the middle.
The cat. It's always one.
Very
man.
Upset we're doing other things.
It's always one man carrying the other, either Sean carrying him in the wrestling terms, carrying Bulldog, or Bulldog literally carrying Sean around. There were a couple really good spots in this match.
Because he's well strong.
Yeah. there were a couple really good spots in this match, and I think there was a lot of good psychology that they were trying to get at, but the execution was just bland.
They missed a step. I feel like I failed Mankind the Undertaker. I do not feel that way about the main event.
I didn't like... That they kind of did a repeat of last month's main event finish.
With the do-revs?
Yeah, that seemed stupid from the start.
Right, but they didn't really touch on it much. That was clearly... To be honest with you, again, that feels like something Cornette added in so that he would have some shit to talk about.
Maybe, I don't know. I think Perfect did a cool job. I think it was cool that this, obviously, you know, we're building him up to be a heel. He's going to interfere, and then he didn't. That's both a waste of your resources, but also a great bait and switch for the crowd. Like, so that the crowd goes, well, okay, what's Perfect about then?
Yeah, it gives some nuance to the character. And he literally didn't cheat. Like, he was going to count that three.
Until Owen dragged him out.
Owen dragged him out. And then when they did the beatdown, Mr. Perfect did not join in.
No, he didn't.
He just went home.
Well, I'm all out of bubblegum, so...
Well, if you stop knocking it into the crowd...
Don't you tell me what to do.
This show happened. Like, I...
Yeah, for... I mean, all the hype, you know, people look back and talk about how great this event was. And it's galvanizing in a lot of ways. This was the engine turning over to what brought the WWF in this time out of the mire. And I mean, it's a long fight. It is a long fight because they still got a lot of late 80s to shake off.
But you also had shit like Brian Pillman showing up and cutting a straight up Attitude Era promo.
I think he went a little too far.
I do too. But that's kind of the idea behind the Attitude Era.
Yeah, I didn't, because I've also seen Brian Pillman. This was Brian Pillman coming over from WCW. I think the only reason he had crutches and stuff is because he was still under a no-compete.
Yeah, something like that.
He's still under contract or something. So, you know, he couldn't do anything. But I don't know, man. The promo, it wasn't...
I don't think he went too far. I think he went too long.
Maybe.
I think he went about 2 minutes too long. I didn't say anything worse in those last 2 minutes. He just overstayed his welcome.
I guess it's just that wrestling logic of, you know, try to keep it a little realistic, you know?
Well, I mean, like...
Like, there's a line between I'm going to kick your ass and I am going to rape, pillage, and burn down this company. I don't know.
You could make that line work, I think.
You could. I don't think he did as great of a job as people sell him as. And maybe that's it. Maybe I'm looking back through, you know, other people's rose-tinted glasses and going, I don't know. Hype backlash, as it were. I liked him better in the WCW. I thought he was pretty legitimate as part of the Four Horsemen. I thought he added an interesting element. Chris Benoit replaced him really well in that sense. They both occupied similar character space.
But I just...
That wasn't a joke, but it...
Good boy!
It is kind of,
Alright, so... But yeah, I think Brian Pillman's whole gimmick was that Brian Pillman goes just a dash too far.
Sure.
Pillman does indeed have a gun.
Sure.
After all.
And I think as crazy as that whole angle was, like, if I had watched it at the time, I would have been sold because I was a kid.
Exactly.
But, like, I think that goes so far that it starts to blur the lines of, why would they let him have a gun on the TV show?
And more so, even if it was live, why would they let him come back?
Yeah.
Once you pull a gun, you get fired.
That's not how that works at all.
That's...
I think wrestling might be fake, you guys.
Why would they let Abyss kill Rob Van Dam? I mean,
yeah, exactly. That's a ridiculous example. It's nowhere near as quote unquote cool, but what the fuck? Ninjas? Just TNA in general. God damn.
Sometimes ninjas work.
That's long and complicated.
But I don't know. Like, I feel like the experiment isn't over, by the way.
No, certainly not. I mean, you know, because even through the course of this conversation, I feel like there have been a couple of points brought up to where, you know, maybe even if we'd seen the build, would we really have given a shit about Bulldog versus HBK?
There's no universe where I give a shit about that match. I'm sorry.
So, I don't know. It's hard to say. And you know, knowing how the match ends between Snake and Austin and you know, taking away that hope.
So, you know what? Actually, side note, in the first round match, in the semifinal with him versus Mero, obviously I know who's winning that match, and they still got me a couple times.
Yeah, like, you mentioned.
There were a couple roll-up. Like, there was a roll-up. Mero went for a roll-up, And, like, they started doing the count, and my head almost involuntarily snapped back to the screen from, like, I was looking at my phone, I was like, oh, shit, is it gonna be three?
Well, and that's something like, else, too.
It was, like, an instinctual reaction, and that doesn't happen unless I'm a little into the match, at least.
More well-trained professional commentators on wrestling, wrestling historians, if you will, have said better than us that the old mentality of really long early stage matches in your King of the Ring or any tournament culminating in short ass, you know, dirty brawls as the end is smart and logical in terms of
as layering. The tournament goes on, they'll get more tired, yeah. They're more beaten up.
But at the same time, more desperate. But at the same time, it's not as good of a match. So even though you knew Stone Cold was going over Mark Mero and Stone Cold put on a good enough match that you were like, what's going to happen? Like, instinctually. Even if immediately, even if before the ref counted two, you were like, oh, no, duh, I'm stupid.
Which is exactly what happened.
You still looked. But during Jake the Snake and Stone Cold, it's like, okay, how does this end? Oh, all right.
Because it's like, it's not a match. There isn't a wrestling match happening.
Sure, it's just a little brawl, and we're just waiting for it to be over with. So there's something to be said for the turnaround in psychology there, and maybe in general that's why they act the King of the Ring as a larger tournament. Now, it may be coming back if you vote on those WWE Network surveys, if any of you got those like we did.
Please.
Yeah, they're thinking about running it as a separate tournament like the CWC and...
Shit, yeah!
Yeah, that'd be tight. I'd watch that. But, yeah, this experiment is not over yet. We've got plenty of great stuff to see. And
we've got literally enough pay-per-views to make an adult human who can drink.
Yes. Yes, we do. I pointed that out during the Billy Gunn match because I was thinking about, you know, oh, I could tell him, you know, oh, man, just the other day, we're gonna go see... him wrestle a local show. And, you know, if I get the chance to get an autograph or whatever, I can be like, man, I just was watching you the other day. It was a match from 20 years ago? 21 years ago. And I was like, damn, boy, this pay-per-view is old enough to drink. And little gears turned in his head, and he was like, shit, yeah, it is.
It was better than that, because I went, yep. Because that's just a fact.
Yeah.
And right. Then my brain processed the meaning behind those words, and I went, fuck.
I don't get that whole, you know, oh, I'm so old. I mean, I joke about it, but yeah, as you'll see eventually. And I actually have made the video this time, so you will see it eventually.
Uh-huh, sure, okay.
stay tuned this Friday if you're on Patreon, if not next Friday. But I make jokes about it, but it doesn't really... Okay, yes, I have been on this earth for 32 years. I'm fully aware. This is not something that has escaped my attention. Time continues to pass.
It's not age for me. It's the never-ending, grinding destruction of my physical form.
Oh, this was 21 years ago. That explains a lot about why my parts don't work anymore.
Oh, my chassis is several editions out of date.
We're farting around at this point. So,
I mean, we've been farting around for like 10 minutes. Yeah. But, yeah, I think we're done here.
I think we are. King of the Ring 96, not as good as you remember. But still good.
Good show.
Yeah, still good.
Everything's better when nerds talk about it. Fuck it, let's get hot!